three trees in the Bible. Isn't it interesting how different cultures portray different ideas? The desert people among whom we worked in the Somali desert in Africa attached human and moral attributes to hills, to trees, and to mountains. The forest people that we worked with in the south of the country tend to attach human attributes to large trees that were in the forest. This morning, I want to take three trees out of the Bible and talk about what we learn from these three trees and what they portray. The first one is over in Genesis chapter 2, verse 9, and I have entitled it, The Tree of Knowledge. Listen as I read here. Out of the ground the Lord caused to grow every tree that is pleasing to sight and good for food, the tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And then further down in verse 17 it says, But from the tree of knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat from it you shall surely die. There almost seems to be a contradiction in what is being set forth here. If it is the tree of knowledge, why should I not eat from it? If it's going to give me the ability to determine what is good and what is evil, then should I not partake of that fruit all the more so that I may clearly understand from my perspective what God considers to be good and on the other hand what he considers to be evil? Inherent within creation, back there with the primeval pair, was this tree called the tree of knowledge. In Genesis 3:6, we have an interesting development. When the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was desirable to make one wise, the tree of knowledge, remember, she took from its fruit and ate, and she gave also to her husband, and he ate. The very thing that God had told them don't do, suddenly they do. They took from this tree of knowledge, and they eat. And what does it say? And then their eyes were opened, and they began to understand, and they knew things. And so this tree of knowledge, in one way, was a desirable thing, but in another, it was a catastrophe to them. They lost their innocence. They immediately knew good from evil. And my question was, as I prepared this or started to a couple of weeks ago, did they not understand before they ate of that fruit what was good and what was evil? Or was there no real evil there before? Why did suddenly the eating of that fruit and this tree of knowledge give them the power to determine what was good and what was bad? The unspoken thing I find within the text of Genesis here is that it almost appears that that eating of the fruit gave them a propensity towards the evil act. Had they done wrong before? No, I don't think so. Was it the fruit or the knowledge of what could be done that caused them to do the things that they then began to do and estrange them from God? Until this point, the Bible is not involved in the value system. Adam and Eve knew no evil. I don't believe they realized they had a value system because apparently they did not need to make choices. Oh, how I wish that at times I didn't have to make a choice between the lesser of two evils, between good and bad, between the course of action of my own life. I've often wished I could go into the garden and whisper in Eve's ear, Eve, don't touch it. And she would have looked at me and she would have said, Kevin, you dummy, if I don't, you will. And that's about right. None of us back there would have got that fruit and we would have eaten it. And we tend to blame the nature that we have on all kinds of conditions, but the truth is that I, like they, have the opportunity to make decisions for good or evil. I wish that the trustees of this church would get on the ball and plant a tree of the knowledge of good and evil out in the yard there. Now, once the fruit is on it, do we say to the kids, don't touch it and don't eat it because we don't want you to know the difference between good and evil? Or do we say to them, go ahead and have a piece of fruit and then you'll know the difference? To know the difference is great. To do the difference is what caused them the problems in the garden. And so the knowledge of good and evil is something that all of us would need to know. And I would say for people like me, Mary would say to me, Kevin, have three or four pieces just so you can really understand the difference between the choices that you need to make in life. And knowing Kevin, I probably would have to take half a dozen before it sunk in. I need to eat of that tree to know the difference between good and evil. But I need also the courage in my Christian stance to resist evil. As I sat at my desk, I couldn't help writing this. I would give to our youth one basketful of this fruit to take home so that you may know the knowledge of good and evil. Now, you're going to say to me, Pastor Kevin, do you think we're any worse than the rest of the people in the church? No. I think at this stage of your life, you're a lot better than most of us that sit in this church. But as you go down the corridor of life, you as youth are going to have to make decisions. You as youth are going to have to know the things that you do will ultimately have repercussions on your life somewhere down the road. I believe today the Christian Church of the United States is hurting and dying because our knowledge of good and evil is blurred. And our concept of what we can do and can't do as Christians is blurred. We often don't seem to even know right from wrong, but the worst is we don't care at times what is right and what is wrong. We do not want to do as the first pair did, and yet somehow we irresistibly, like some swirling vortex of moral identity, we find ourselves being drawn into it and make the same kind of poor decisions that they made. But we forget there are consequences. Just recently, I saw on the 10 o'clock news, a Palmer youth was killed in an automobile accident and came from one of the high schools down there, and they had a service. And later on, they interviewed the mother. Now, I don't remember whether it was the mother that said this, but she said, my son learned to drink in the basement of our home from his father. And he learned to drink and drive because his father said, if you do it carefully, you don't get caught. On our news in the Cleveland area. What a tragedy. I would say that man needed to take of that fruit of the knowledge of good and evil and pass some of that knowledge and good and evil down through his family to a son that could still be alive today if he had first not learned to drink in the basement out of his father's refrigerator. And secondly, his father said to him, if you learn to drink and drive and do it carefully, you won't get caught. Kids come to Sunday school and church, but at 14, 15, 16, they drop away. Some of you guys are past that. Congratulations. I'm proud of you. I'm proud of your parents. And I pray to God you're going to stay in the church, because with the world in the situation it is today, you don't realize how much you're going to need the moral fiber that the church and its teachings can give you. We need to eat again of that tree of knowledge of good and evil. Today the mighty computer has taken over and the computer tree has grown. It can give us all kinds of things except how to live and how to die. And this tree of the knowledge of good and evil didn't bring ruin to those pair simply because they ate it. They had a choice once they ate it, and it was because of the choices they made, I believe. They forgot God. The tree of knowledge gave them, I read, understanding of good and evil. It enabled them to make choices, to live the life as God wanted, but on the other hand, it also gave them the possibility to live life as they wanted, and that's exactly what they did. The ultimate plan of God of eating from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil gave them the ability to make decisions that destroyed them. Oh, listen to me this morning, especially our young people. It's not other people's decisions that destroy Kevin. It's his own stupid decisions. And it goes along with you too. The decisions that we make are the decisions that we have that destroy us. There's a second tree. I wonder what God thought. In the midst of eternity, he plants a garden, he puts a tree in there, and suddenly things go wrong with his creation. And I imagine God scratched his head and said to himself, what a dummy I was to create these people. No, he didn't say that according to the Bible. But he stepped into the midst of them and began a process of redemption that resulted in a second tree way down the line. He started a blood redemption line that finished on a tree called Calvary. In Acts chapter 5, verse 30, I want you to listen as I read. Acts chapter 5, verse 30 says this, the God of our fathers raised up Jesus, whom you put to death by hanging him on a cross, which was the tree of Calvary. And then in Acts 10:39, we've got the same thing when he says, and we are witnesses of all the things he did both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem, and they also put him to death by hanging him on a cross. Why did this man come to another tree? Because this was the ultimacy of the plan of redemption that God has given to us. This tree is set in contradistinction to the first tree. This tree restores what the first tree took away. The fruit of the first tree was disobedience and gave us this propensity towards wrongdoing. But the tree of Calvary and its fruit gives us the ability to see evil from God's perspective and find forgiveness through the grace of God by the one who hung on this tree. The first tree gave us a nature which enjoyed wrongdoing. And oh, I've got a little bit of that nature in me. And so do you. Isn't wrongdoing fun sometimes? And then you repent of it after. And you realize just who you are inside and how much you need that redemptive touch of the second tree to enter your life to change who you are and what you are and what you do. The second tree is a nature given to us that loves right. You see, the first tree was ultimately called the tree of disobedience, and that nature is within us. But the second tree of Calvary, that redemptive tree, gives to me a nature when I know what to do and how to do right, but often don't choose to do it. It rectified the nature which arose from that first tree. The scripture says, we become by this tree a new creature. We receive by this tree a new nature, not from the wood of the tree, but from the one who hung upon it. And so the second tree was a product that was required by the consequences of that first tree. Recently, I saw also on TV the flooding in the south. I believe it was on the eastern, southeastern section of the United States. And it showed two people clinging to a large tree that was being washed down a raging torrent. Any of you see that? Yeah, several of you are nodding your heads. And I thought, what a tragedy. How frightening to be out there in that raging torrent and there's no way to get off of that tree. The worst thing is, I don't know if they're rescued. I don't know the end of the story. But one thing I do know, that was obvious, as long as they held onto that tree, they were safe. And that's the story that we get from the cross. As long as we stay close to the cross and accept the cross and recognize the power of that cross, we are safe. The cross or the tree of Calvary is our security from the raging torrent of life that threatens to overwhelm us and flood us. It restores our relationship to God, and that which was broken as now is restored in a new, fresh, dynamic, clean relationship. It gives us the ability to choose between good and evil. But listen, the propensity for wrongdoing is always there. Whether it's the preacher that came to Christ over 40 years ago, or whether it's the young man or woman in the pew that may have been last week you came to Christ, the nature of the old tree is going to remain with you, and that is not just the knowledge of good and evil, but the tree of good and evil causes us often to make the wrong choices. But there's a third tree. In Genesis, if we go back there to the text that we began from, in exactly the same verse or passage there, it says this, "And out of the ground the Lord caused to grow every tree that is pleasing to the sight and good for food, the tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of knowledge of good and evil." The tree of life. When I turn over to Revelation, I find there are several mentions to this tree, and I just want to give you a couple of them this morning. In Revelation chapter 2, verse 7, these are the words we find there, written by John. "He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will grant to eat of the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God." And then if you turn over to Revelation chapter 22, again, we've got exactly the same thing in verse 2 when he says, "In the middle of the street and on either side of the river was the tree of life, bearing 12 kinds of fruit, yielding its fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations." And then in verse 14 it says, "Blessed are those who wash their robes that they may have the right to the tree of life." What is this tree of life? We've got the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. We've got the tree of Calvary. And then we've got the tree of life. I believe the tree of life is the fullness of what Calvary ultimately brings. We can't taste yet of the tree of this kind of life because we've not been completely redeemed. My soul and my spirit is redeemed, but my body, Paul says, is waiting for that day of redemption when he shall return, or waiting ultimately till I die on the resurrection morn when I shall be transformed into his likeness. That's the day I shall eat of the tree of life and know the fullness of the life of God flowing through me. In Genesis 3:6, Eve ate, then gave some to Adam. But it was not the fruit which destroyed them, it was their ability to choose. They made the wrong choice. As you move further along, the children of Adam and Eve, which are us, have the ability to make a second choice, and that choice is accepting Jesus Christ as our own personal Savior. And many of us have already done that, and it's required of us that we should do it. And the third one is that ultimately through that second choice, we can one day eat of that tree of life. The ultimate reward for life through the tree of Calvary is the full redemption that Paul spoke of. And listen as I read Romans 8, 22, verse B. "Until then, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting eagerly for our adoption as children, the redemption of our body." Three trees in the Bible. A tree of wrong choice. A tree that reestablishes relationship. And ultimately the tree right in the very heart of God called the tree of life that one day we shall eat of when we shall know the fullness of God and the blessing of God because of our relationship to him through Jesus Christ our Lord. It is through him and him alone that we receive life, an abundant life in Christ. Amen.